8 o'clock, and we'll take a start. Okay, yesterday we started off by looking at the pharmacology of the pancreas. We looked at the pancreas in terms of its exocrine functions and then endocrine functions. For the exocrine, we looked at the digestive enzymes that are produced by the pancreas and what you use those digestive enzymes for, and we divided them into your pancreatic and pancreatin products. And then we looked at the endocrine function of the pancreas. We looked at the cells that you have in your islets of Langerhans, alpha, beta, delta, and of course your P cells or the PP cells. And we looked at the productions or the secretions of those cells, what they do in the body, and which ones are available as drugs. So we ended up with your beta cells, where we talked about amylin, and then we focused on insulin. And with insulin, we looked at the natural sources of your insulin and how changing one or two amino acids can actually affect the pharmacokinetics of your insulin products. And then we look at how insulin does what it does in the body, that is the mechanism of action and the physiologic effects of your insulin. And then we look at the ADME using insulin R, that is regular insulin, as the representative agent, routes of administration, and why you would use IV or IM, or in what situations we'll use that. And we mentioned that the subcutaneous will be the maintenance route of administration of your insulin. And then we looked at the distribution in terms of plasma protein binding and the metabolism, and then of course the excretory route of your insulin. And then we discussed the mechanism of action of insulin, and that was where we stopped. Pick up from there by looking at the adverse effects of insulin. I'm talking about the indications. And so to start from there, the adverse effects of insulin can include hypoglycemia. Hypoglycemia is one of the adverse effects. DKA, diabetic ketoacidosis, I was mentioned that last time. And it can also produce some swelling or edema. And that edema can actually lead to an increase in weight. And then insulin can also cause some hypersensitivity reactions, especially if you don't use human-derived insulin, and there's some hypersensitivity. sensitivity reactions. And then resistance. Insulin resistance is considered to be an adverse effect of your insulin. And then lipodystrophy is one of the adverse effects of your insulin. So we can look at lipodystrophy first. You can have two forms, that is lipoatrophy. Okay, lipoatrophy, as you see in the name, you have some depression of the skin at the site of injection, especially if you don't allow 1 month to pass before you inject within 1 inch of the original injection site. And basically what happens is that the lipid tissue or the adipose tissue in that area will atrophy, that is, will break down. And so if you touch the skin, you see a depression of the skin in that area. But you can also have lipohypertrophy, in which case fat or adipose tissues will accumulate at the site of injection. Okay, so that would be lipohypertrophy. There's a drug called Myalept. Myalept is designed to actually manage insulin-induced lipodystrophy. So that's one way that we should manage lipodystrophy caused by your insulin. Insulin resistance can occur, and the way you overcome that is to give a higher concentration of insulin. That's an insulin that is U500, that is, it contains 500 units per ml. So that's a very high concentration of insulin, and that's what you can do to actually overcome that insulin resistance. Hypersensitivity, not often encountered anymore because you use human-derived insulin. But if it occurs, then one can just give prednisone to help manage that hypersensitivity reaction. And the edema is one that can lead to weight gain. Basically, fortunately, it just undergoes spontaneous resolution. So it just gets resolved on its own after some time. Okay. And you can prevent that edema from occurring by picking the right insulin to use. There are some insulins that would cause less weight gain. Usually those are insulins that are ultra rapid in terms of their actions. And DKA, diabetic ketoacidosis, you just use continuous but small doses of insulin, and it can reverse the diabetic ketoacidosis. But the main concern when you're using insulin is the possible hypoglycemia. that may result. There are three levels of glucose in the bloodstream. You can have hyperglycemia. Let's say your plasma glucose goes up to 400 milligrams per deciliter. And at the level in the middle here, let's say that's about 120 milligrams per deciliter, which would be within normal range. The normal range is 80 to 120 milligrams per deciliter. Okay. And then down here, let's say you have 60 milligrams per deciliter. So you can have a drug that will bring your high levels of glucose down to what's normal. So that drug is reducing your plasma glucose, but it is not causing hypoglycemia. Okay? So you have a reduction in plasma glucose, but you are not producing hypoglycemia. If the drug were to bring your high level all the way down towards, say, 40 or 60, then that would be a drug that is causing hypoglycemia. So reduction of plasma glucose does not necessarily mean you're getting to hypoglycemic levels. So when we're talking about adverse effects of insulin being hypoglycemia, it means that it can bring it down towards normal or even dip below that. And that's when you say it's a hypoglycemic effect. Okay. The hypoglycemia, or the signs and symptoms of hypoglycemia that you see with insulin, can be divided into two types. You have some symptoms that are autonomic nature, and some that are neuroglycopenic in nature. Okay. The symptoms that are autonomic in nature would include things like palpitations. Okay. The patient may experience palpitations, you may see an increase in heart rate, for instance. They would experience some hunger and some sweating. Those are all considered autonomic. Tremors, they would experience that. Anxiety would be another manifestation of that autonomic type of hypoglycemia. Paresthesias. Another one. Okay. So those would be your autonomic symptoms of hypoglycemia induced by insulin. The ones that are neuroglycopenic would be things like dizziness. Patient may experience dizziness, may experience drowsiness, confusion. They confused. They will have a problem concentrating. Okay. The ability to concentrate will be reduced. And then you may absolutely see loss of consciousness as part of that. They will experience some warmth all over the body. Okay. All those are considered to be the neuroglycopenic manifestations of insulin-induced hypoglycemia. And the way you would manage that hypoglycemia, of course, would be to give glucagon. That would be one thing you can do. Or you can give proglycin, that we mentioned yesterday. Or they can just grab a bar of Snickers, you know, that is candy, to bring the blood glucose up. Or you can inject epinephrine. Epinephrine is one of your catecholamines that we mentioned yesterday, is a counter-regulatory hormone. Remember, we mentioned those four yesterday that can bring the blood glucose back up. So, those are the adverse effects of insulin. And the last thing we have to do here is to classify your different insulin preparations. So, the insulin preparations classified as things like your ultra rapid insulins, okay, and then your rapid acting insulins, and then your short acting, and then your intermediate acting. And then, of course, the long-acting insulins. The ultra-rapid insulins are these two that are administered by inhalation, Exubera and Afrezza, and also Biojet, which is given subcutaneously, and FIASP. So these 1, 2, 3, 4, those are considered to be ultra-rapid acting insulins. The ultra-rapid acting insulins usually produce less weight gain, and they also produce less hypoglycemia. So the ultra-rapid insulins produce less weight gain, and they produce less hypoglycemia. And then, of course, you have the rapid-acting insulins, which will reduce your hemolog, novolog, and analog is a biosimilar preparation of humalog. Okay. You would hear some people say that analog is a genetic form of humalog. Strictly speaking, that is incorrect. Okay. If you have a small molecule, you can duplicate that small molecule and market it as a drug. It's possible in that sense to have a generic formulation of the drug. that we have the same compound, the same admin, that is the same pharmacokinetic properties, and will be classified as a generic. For biologicals, it is very difficult to create an exact replica of that biological compound. And so it cannot be a generic, and that's why you use the term biosimilar, biologically similar to that biological compound. Okay, so amylone, strictly speaking, is a biosimilar product, you know, of your humalog. It's not really a true generic. If you look at this agent here, Basandra is a biosimilar formulation of your insulin glargine, that is lactase. It is not a generic form of your lactase. You can see one that is consumably, is also a biosimilar preparation of insulin glargine or the lactase. So, yeah, the lay people will just call it a generic form, but strictly speaking, it is not. That's the difference between your biosimilar compounds and your generic compounds. Okay. And of course, we have novolog and apidra, so all those are rapid acting compounds. You can use the onset of action of your insulin preparations to actually divide them this way. But the best parameter to use is actually the duration of action. So if you use the duration of action, you would have your rapid and even some of your ultra rapid agents having a duration of action of anywhere from 2 to 4 or 5 hours. The short acting agents would be like from 6 to 8 hours in terms of duration. Your intermediate acting will be from about 16 to 24 hours. And then the long acting will be those that will act for longer than 24 hours. Okay. Some people like to say very long acting when you're talking about this particular compound, placebo, because placebo or insulin degludec can remain active for about 42 hours. So it's very long acting, but we will just classify that as long acting. Okay. And then you have your Himalayan R, which means regular, Himalayan R, and those the Losulin, which would be your short-acting agents. Okay. And Himalayan N, the N there referring to NPH. And NPH, up actually stands for neutral protamine haplogroup. And Allegram, of course, is the name of an individual that first made the NPH. And you know what neutral refers to, neutral pH. And protamine, anytime you add protamine to any insulin preparation, it increases the duration of action of that insulin. You know, so for instance, if you have a rapid acting agent, okay, say a pedra or what have you, and you add protamine to it, it then becomes basically an intermediate acting agent. So NPH is also sometimes referred to as isophane. Isophane insulin preparation. And the problem there really is that protamine. Where did you come across protamine? Maybe you can start. Protamine is used for what? It's a what?
Antidote
to what?
Heparin.
And where do you get the protamine sulfate from? What's the original source of protamine sulfate? From fish. Exactly. And why is that important? What did we say yesterday about taking a protein from one animal and putting it in another animal? What happens? Hypersensitivity reaction. That is why the number one adverse effect of protamine sulfate is hypersensitivity reaction. Okay. You see a lot of histamine being produced, you get vasodilation, blood pressure will drop, the patient will faint. So that's one thing that one watches out for. Okay, so that would be your isophane insulin suspension. Okay. And anytime you see a combination insulin preparation, let's say, Himalayan 70-30, for instance. That numerator, the number at the top, always refers to the longer acting of the two preparations in there. Okay. So they may contain your NPH, the 70 units, to 30 of, say, your R. So the number at the top usually refers to the longer acting of the two preparations. Okay. Right. So we have your R's, and then the N's, of course, will be the intermediate acting agents, and L refers to lentiger. Your insulin preparations today actually contain, to varying degrees, some zinc in them. Okay. and they are all prepared at your close to your neutral pH, about 7.2 to 7.4. And that is what has increased their ability to be stable at room temperature. That's why you can leave your insulin at room temperature for even up to 28 days. So it increases their stability. Long-acting agents, we see the lactose, and then which is insulin glargine, and you see the Sandra, which is a biosimilar preparation. And Tujero, of course, is a more concentrated insulin glargine. Because normally your insulin preparations will contain 100 units per mil under normal conditions. There are some exceptions, of course. 100 units of insulin is equivalent to 3.6 milligrams of insulin. And you usually have them as 100 units per mil, but Tujero has insulin glargine at 300 mils per minute. That pen contains 1.5 mLs. So the total amount of insulin glargine in Tujero is 450 units in that pen. That is good. 300 is containing 1 mL, and 1.5 will be 450 units per mL. Okay. There are some other agents that don't contain just 100 units. For instance, this Prozac contains 40 units per mL. It's mostly used for cats and dogs. Vetsulin is also, as you say, veterinary, so it's also cats and dogs' insulin. They have made some Prozac now that is 100 units per mil, but you can see the 40 units per mil. Your Tresiba, for instance, you have 100 units and you also have 200 units per mil. Insulin degludec, which is Tresiba. Your Humalog also has like 100 and 200 units per mil. And remember we said as Humulin R, that actually contains 500 units per mil, and that's the one we use to treat insulin resistance. It's a very high concentration. Okay, Levemir, another long acting agent, and of course, you in Humulin U is ultra lente, which was ultra long. And Tresiba is your insulin degludec. And sometimes you have these insulin preparations combined with other agents. For instance, insulin degludec, which is the Tresiba, is combined with your Novolog. That's what you have in Rizodec. So Razodec is a combination of placebo or insulin, Demodec was your novel one, your insulin aspart. And that's another one that's very easy to remember how or why it was named insulin aspart. It's because you changed the proline on B28. Remember we said on that chain, 28 would be the proline, and then 29 would be glycine. If you replace that proline with aspartic acid, you get your insulin aspart. So it's only one change, just changing proline to aspartic acid, you get your insulin aspart. Okay. So that combination is in your Razodec. Once you have insulin aspart, okay, and you add niacinamide, and you also add some glycine, what you will get is that Fiasp. So if you look at the Fiasp name and you break it down like that, it's just a faster acting insulin aspart. And that's where you see number four here, Fiasp. So Fiasp is actually a faster acting form of your insulin aspart. Okay. Yes. If you take that insulin Demodec, which is placebo, and you add it to Victoza, which is your liraglutide, Zelotoffee. So Zelotoffee is a combination of liraglutide and insulin every day. And if you can combine lixisenatide, which is the class we'll be talking about next, lixisenatide, and you combine it with your insulin glargine, that is lantus, what you will get is Soliqua. So Soliqua is a combination of lixisenatide and insulin glargine. And lastly, you have different ways of delivering insulin. One, you have some vials where you just withdraw the required amount to be injected subcutaneously. And you can have some that are in pens and cartridges. Pre-filled pens, you can deliver insulin that way. And there's something that is called sliding scale that is less used often today. Basically, you give a certain amount of insulin based on the plasma glucose, you know, through a pump. Then, of course, you have your continuous subcutaneous insulin infusion pump. And you have many of those now that are coming up the market, you know, selling on a certain amount of insulin will be injected, and you can mention some of them. Now that Omnipod, you have one that is called Novolin Echo. You can see news. Tandem, Slim. That's another one. Animas Vibe. That's another one that you can see. So those are some examples of these forms that can give you continuous insulin injection. Okay. And you can deliver insulin by using what is called a basal insulin administration versus bolus insulin administration system. Basically, the basal insulin will be a long-acting insulin or an intermediate-acting insulin. If we do this, you can give an intermediate-acting insulin that will say last for 12 hours, and then you give another one that will cover the rest of the 24 hours. Okay, or you can give very long-acting agent like your placebo that will cover all the 24 hours. And then during each period of a meal, you give a short or rapid acting agent. Okay. So the basal covers the base for 12 hours or for 24 hours. The bolus will cover postprandial time. Just right after the meal, you can give one that will cover just that meal period, the increase in glucose following a meal. So we have those different delivery methods of your insulin, and of course we've mentioned the ones that can be administered by inhalation using that steamboat device. And often you can see the these pumps, you know, used in combination with a CGM, continuous glucose monitoring device. You know, continuous glucose monitoring device. Here in the US, you basically have two of them, you know, Dexcom G6. They have now made a Dexcom G7, so it keeps getting better and smaller. And you just put a sensor, usually on the back side of the upper arm, and it would basically sense the concentration of glucose, and it would use a transmitter to transmit the information to a device like a cell phone. Yes?
I'm interested, but you said continuous glucose monitoring and Dexcom is an example of which delivery system?
Yeah, Dexcom G6 or Dexcom G7 is an example of a continuous glucose monitoring device. Yeah. You have one that is called Freestyle Libre. Used to be Freestyle Libre, Freestyle Libre 2, and now the newest one is Libre 3. That's another example of a CGM. Use 140 milligrams per deciliter as the beginning. If the plasma glucose is 140 or less, then you give zero insulin in that pump. And if it's greater than 140 and then up to 200 milligrams per deciliter, the pump would be injecting 2 units of insulin. And from 201 to 300, it will be injecting 5 units of insulin. And if it's, you know, 300 to, that is 301 to about 400, then it will be injecting 10 units. greater than 400 milligrams per deciliter, we give 12 units. That's what the pump will be injecting into the patient. Yeah, that used to be a lifesaver when the coping pump started, but now because of this continuous injecting pumps, slider scale has lost some, you know, favor, if you will. But in some clinics, you can still see it used, you know, when the patient checks in. Every 5 minutes. Every 5 minutes is going to take a reading of your glucose. People think that it goes into the blood and checks your blood levels of glucose. No, it actually measures what's in the interstitial fluid. So it's not the blood itself. It measures what's in the interstitial fluid, and that has been computed to, you know, reflect the plasma glucose. Yeah. I'm just leaving it there. There are some now that you put on in the lower mid of the eye. It's like a little wire that has the sensor in it. You just stick it in the eye, lower the eye, and it measures the glucose in the eye fluid and correlates it to the plasma glucose level. And then it goes through the sensor and the transmitter and it goes straight to your app, you know, on your cell phone. There are others, you know, sugar beat, glucose track, that would use a laser beam to determine the amount of glucose in the eye, and also sends it to your iPad and to your iPhone. There are many of them being tried. There's one that you just keep between the thumb and the index finger like that, you hold it, and it takes that interstitial fluid away and sends it straight to your iPhone. So many of them. Okay, so that's what we have for your insulin. Polypeptide. done like peptide one, and then glucose dependent insulinotropic polypeptide. Those are the incretins that will be released in response to your ingestion of food. So these incretins, that is your GLP-1 and GIP, when they are released, they will actually go to the B cells of your pancreas and increase the responsiveness of your B cells to the glucose that is circulating through the body, through your bloodstream. Okay, so the B cells will then produce more insulin so that the insulin can now control or modulate your level of glucose. So that's why you don't get hyperglycemia all the time, because the body has the means of controlling that glucose when you eat. Before we go on into the incretins, there is a condition that is called reactive hypoglycemia, you know, which runs counter to what you expect when you eat. In other words, there are some situations when after eating, a patient will actually experience the signs and symptoms of hypoglycemia. You know, all those things that we talked about, the autonomic symptoms of hypoglycemia, your neuroglycopenic symptoms. So the patient will actually have those symptoms. But when you take a measurement of the plasma glucose, it will be within the 80 to 120 milligrams per deciliter. It will be within normal range. Okay? So in truth, the patient really doesn't have hypoglycemia based on the reading and the plasma. It's a phenomenon that is not understood in terms of its occurrence. That's why you see sometimes people refer to it as an idiopathic hypoglycemia, because you really don't know the origin or the cause of that particular reaction. Okay. So it can happen. But normally when you eat, you get your postprandial increase glucose. And then your incretins will be produced, and then they will go to the B cells and you have insulin released. Now the problem is that when your GIP and GLP are produced, that is those incretins, you will have that enzyme dipeptidyl peptidase 4 that will be released, and dipeptidyl peptidase will go on and basically metabolize your incretins, so they don't stay alive for too long. So you see, if you can inhibit DPP-4, then you can have your incretins active for a longer period of time, And you can have insulin being produced, and that can bring your plasma glucose down. Okay, so that's why DPP-4 inhibitors can be used to treat diabetes. In other words, if you nullify this enzyme that would normally break down your incretins, then your incretins will stay alive longer and will do their actions on the B cells or the beta cells, rather, to remove insulin, which can then control plasma glucose. And DPP-4 is not the only one in the body, just to mention that on the side. You also have DPP-8, you have DPP-9. DPP-8 is involved in inflammation process in the GI tract, and DPP-9 actually works on antigen presentation to your immune system. Okay, so just to mention those in passing. All right, so you have some drugs then that will mimic the actions of your incretins. So those drugs are called incretinomimetic agents, or you just call them incretin mimetics. These are agents that would act as agonists on the receptors of your incretins. Okay. So they will act as agonists on the receptors for your GLP and GIP. Okay. Now, what is the function of those, or what do those incretins do in the body, the physiologic effects of your incretins? One, you will see a decrease in glucagon production. Two, you will see a decrease in appetite. Three, you will see a decrease in, or a delay in, gastric emptying. And then four, you will see an increase in glucose-dependent insulin production. And so if you look at numbers 2 and 3, okay, if you have a decrease in appetite and you have an increase in gastric emptying time, okay, that means you will feel full all the time, and so that can lead then to a decrease in weight. If you're not eating, if you don't have appetite, most likely your body weight will go down. Yeah, they can work in the absence of food, yes. Because they just, they are analysts at those receptors for the incretins, yes. Okay, so these are characteristics of your incretinomimetics, all these things. Now, the there are some things that are also common to your increase in your magnetic scale, which you mentioned. You can see them. Cause an inflammation of the pancreas, pancreatitis. And you can also see them increase the risk of thyroid C cell tumors. And that C actually stands for calcitonin. You know, thyroid cells that produce calcitonin. And that's one of the things you measure if you want to determine if there's a pathological condition in the thyroid. You measure the levels of calcitonin in the blood. So all these six things are usually bound with your incretinal magnetics. And then they act a lot on the GI tract or produce a lot of adverse effects on the GI tract. So you have nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea. And through the excessive vomiting and diarrhea, you get a loss of body fluid. And that loss of body fluid can lead to an acute renal dysfunction. Okay. So you can see that with those agents also. So they cause a lot of nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea. Through that, you lose a lot of fluid, so you become dehydrated. Dehydration can lead to acute renal dysfunction, as you can see with these drugs. So we can leave those there and start with some listings. So we have an agent that is called exenatide, like you can see as Viagra, and we also see as Viagra. And then we have lixisenatide. And then you have liraglutide, mention also that one, Victoza, albiglutide, albiglutide. Agent there. And we'll do that. And do that. Exenatide, of course, was the first incretinomimetic that was made. still as Viagra. Bydureon is a longer acting formulation of exenatide. Okay, so for Bydureon, for instance, you can give 2 milligrams subcutaneously on a weekly basis. Okay, the preparation comes in the form that you refrigerate, but you can take out a tray of your Bydureon, leave it at room temperature, and it can last for up to 4 weeks. Viagra, you would normally give on a BID basis. A BID basis, and would be administered subcutaneously. Of course, you start with 5 micrograms subcutaneously BID, and then you can titrate that up to 10 micrograms BID. And these agents are basically used for your type 2 diabetes mellitus. Okay. And so in terms of the actions of your exenatide, it will be all of this. That is what the incretins do. That's what these drugs will do. They will be agonistic at the receptors of your GLP-1 and GIP, and so they can produce these 4 effects in terms of physiological actions. And the adverse effects that you can see with Viagra, again, the drug is relatively safe, so you can get nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea. Then you can get headaches. So headaches, nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea. You can have a decrease in weight, that is weight loss. And you can see hypoglycemia as an adverse effect of your Viagra. That hypoglycemia is more likely to result from a combination of, say, Viagra with your sulfonylureas or with insulin. So if you give Viagra in combination with sulfonylurea, you're more likely to get hypoglycemia. And then to some extent, it also produces dizziness. And as it is with all these incretinomimetic agents, Viagra can also cause an increased risk of your TCT, the thyroid cell tube. That is only based on animal results. There's been no result or no trial that actually shows the exenatide causing your thyroid cell tumor in humans. But you still have to mention that cautionary statement in case the patient or members of their family, okay, have a thyroid problem. So in other words, the drug will be contraindicated, and that goes for all your incretinomimetics. They will be contraindicated in a patient who has your medullary thyroid cancer. If they had medullary thyroid cancer, or members of their family have had medullary thyroid cancer, you don't want to use an incretinomimetic. Or if they have had multiple neoplasia, that's cancer also. Of the thyroid cells, okay. Then you don't want to use incretinomagnets in those individuals. Okay, so those would be the adverse effects of your exenatide. As the representative agent, then mixocenotide is another incretinomagnet. We mentioned how that is combined with your glargine, insulin glargine. The glutides to be the next folder. By the way, Byetta will only give you a 0.7 to 0.9% A1C drop. Not just Byetta, but exenatide. Will give you 0.7 to about 0.9% A1C drop. Your insulin as a whole will give you about 1 to 2% drop in A1C, so they're very good. Okay. Now the liraglutide group, that group is also, of course, incretinomagnetic agents, and you can see liraglutide as Victoza. You can also see it as Saxenda. The Victoza preparation is the one that you use for diabetes management. Again, just type 2. Okay, just type 2. Saxenda is used for weight reduction. The usual dosage of liraglutide or Victoza is 0.6 to 1.8 milligrams per day, and you give it subcutaneously. Okay. And liraglutide will give you about 0.7 to 0.8% drop in A1C. Now, the way Saxenda is used, you start with 0.6 milligrams subcutaneously daily for 1 week. And then you increase it the second week by 0.6 milligrams, that is to 1.2 milligrams daily for week 2. And then you increase it to 1.8 milligrams per day for week 3. Okay. So you increase it by 0.6 milligrams every week. So week 4, you go to 2.4 milligrams. And then week 5, you go to 3 milligrams. And you stay there for about 14 to 16 weeks. If you don't get a 4% drop in body weight, that's when you stop Saxenda, because it means it's not going to work in that patient. So again, week 1, 0.6 milligrams. And you keep increasing it by 0.6 every week, you know, on a daily basis, until you get up to 3 milligrams. And then you stay. stay there for about 14 to 16 weeks, we should get at least a 4% drop in body weight. Otherwise, we have to stop. And liraglutide is a little different from your exenatide, because liraglutide has two ways of protecting itself from destruction by that DPP4 enzyme. So number one, it has a fatty acid at the 26th position, which protects it against your dipeptidyl peptidase 4. And then number two, when you administer it, it forms micellar-like aggregates at the point of injection, and that protects it from destruction by your DPP4. And that's what's characteristic of this next four, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So they are more stable, or they basically are not susceptible to destruction by your DPP4. Okay, and again, will be used for weight loss and also for diabetes type 2. And the adverse effects are very similar to those of your exenatide. You can just add some hives that liraglutide can produce sometimes. And all those cautionary statements about pancreatitis and the thyroid cell and all that would also apply to all these four agents. Glutathione, we can actually call that. Nobody really uses it anymore. Trulicity, which is your glutathione, is very commonly used. And glutathione or Trulicity, you give 0.75 to 1.5 milligrams subcutaneously every week. And it will give you an A1 drop of about 1.1%. So it's a little better than your liraglutide. And then semaglutide is actually the best of those four. And I say it's the best because number one, you can give it directly, that is subcutaneously, but can also be administered orally. The Ozempic, of course, will be given by injection or subcutaneously, and so will your Wegovy. Okay. Those will be given subcutaneously, while Rybelsus will be given orally. And you have your 3 milligrams and 7 milligrams and 14 milligrams of Rybelsus. And when you give Rybelsus orally, it has to be administered on an empty stomach. So you give the tablet on an empty stomach. And that will be given actually on a daily basis. For your Ozempic, you will be administering that on a weekly basis. And you have the dosage range of 0.5 to 1 milligrams subcutaneously on a daily, on a weekly basis. Okay. And Wegovy is the one that is specifically made for weight reduction. And it's approved for that. In terms of diabetes, the semaglutide will give you about a 1.5% drop in A1C. So that's one of the reasons why I say it's the best among that group. And it is also the one that is least likely to give you cardiovascular adverse effects. Among those impressional diabetics. So it's a very good drug. When you use it for diabetes, it's just for type 2. And nothing else, not for type 1, not for DKA, it's just for type 2. And all these things I have said before would apply also to semaglutide. Ojjaara or tirzepatide, that's the generic name. You can look that up here. And that's the newest incretinomagnetic agent, and it's different from all the other ones in the sense that it works both on GLP and GIP receptors. All the ones we've talked about before just work on GLP. So all of these mainly just work on GLP-1 receptors. But Mounjaro works, that is, it's an agonist on both your GLP-1 receptors and your GIP receptors. So it works on both of them. Okay, that's Mounjaro. And you would normally get it also subcutaneously. The dosage ranges from 2.5 milligrams all the way to 15 milligrams. Giving it subcutaneously. Actually, it's in 2.5 increments. You have the 2.5 milligrams, then 5, then 7.5, 10, 12.5, and then 15. So it's in 2.5 increments. So that's why Mounjaro is different from all of them. It has not been FDA approved for weight reduction, but most of the people that use Mounjaro today are using it for weight reduction. So in terms of diabetes, it will be used for just type 2, and it gives you a 2.4% drop in A1C levels. In terms of weight reduction, over 12 weeks, it can actually give you about a 50-pound reduction in weight. So it is very good. Unfortunately, most of the people that I will see in the pharmacy coming to get the job are too big. And so you wonder why they're coming for it.
But do you think that,
You can't stop anybody from using the drug for whatever they want to use. As long as he doesn't write the prescription for Mounjaro, right? You dispense it. And they go home and they don't have their meals and they use it for weight loss. How can you stop that? You can't.
So the doctor doesn't have to diagnose them of diabetes to write it?
Does the doctor have to see you to write prescriptions today? So it's very good actually in terms of your reduction of your A1C, like I said. And all these cautionary statements would also apply. How would you know if the patient is having pancreatitis or might have pancreatitis? They will have an abdominal pain that radiates to the back. Okay. And so for a patient on Mondaro, you have to basically tell them that if you ever have an abdominal pain that seems to be radiating to the back, stop it. And contact your doctor because you don't want to get pancreatitis. How would you know if they are getting thyroid-related conditions, like your C-cell tumor? Number one, they will develop a mass around the neck, which will be, like your goiter. Okay, so they will develop a mass around the neck, and then they will have dyspnea. And they will also experience dysphagia, difficulty in swallowing, or painful swallowing. And they will have a persistent hoarseness. So if they experience any of those things, they have to stop them down. And there are some reports of hypersensitivity reaction to Mondaro. So if they start having sore throats and all this nausea, hives, breaking out in hives, they might be allergic or hypersensitive to the Mondaro. And if a patient is still taking oral contraceptives, they should not use Mondaro because it can decrease the effectiveness of the oral contraceptives, and then the baby comes.
Despite the weight loss will still continue.
Okay. Yeah. And you know why? Because if you can't swallow, you have the painful swallowing. You won't eat. Continue. Physiological effects on the incretinal magnetics, but they will all produce those effects, and these are the adverse effects that are common to them. The primary adverse effects of your incretinal magnetic agents, as you see, is related to the GI tract. So, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, dyspepsia, all these things can be the same with those agents. the last group we will mention today. Be your DPP for inhibitors. And that is your peptidase for inhibitors. And those are the ones that you call the gliptins. We call them the gliptins because glucagon-like peptides. So you have linagliptin as one of them. Sitagliptin. And you have saxagliptin. You have amylogliptin. Another one, and you have one that is called Galvus. It's just coming to America. It's been available in Europe for a long time. You know, Galvagliptin is called Galvus, and like I said, that is just coming to the U.S. When we take linagliptin as the representative agent for that group. Linagliptin, in terms of its mechanism of action, it would inhibit DPP-4, okay, and it will also increase insulin production. Okay. So that's in terms of its mechanism of action. Adenine, we always start with the route of administration. A part, and so the drug is administered orally, and it can be given with or without food. So food does not have any clinically important effect on its actions or effects. Okay. Its bioavailability is only about 30%. So the bioavailability factor for your linagliptin is just 30%. And in terms of its half-life, it's a very long half-life, 131 hours. And that's why it can be administered on a QD basis. And the usual dosage is your 5 milligrams pill. QD, that's the usual dosage of linagliptin. And in terms of its plasma protein binding, it is actually dose dependent because the binding to plasma protein by linagliptin is saturable. It's a saturable process. And so the range is from 70% to 90%. Why do we mention plasma protein binding of drugs? It's because number one, it can give you an idea of the duration of action of the drug. It is highly plasma protein bound, and a little bit of the drug is released over time, then its effectiveness will stay there longer. Number two, drugs cross biological membranes, particularly your cerebrospinal fluid you know, that is your blood-brain barrier, when they are free or when they utilize a transport system that is active. So if the drug is highly plasma protein bound, it is very likely not to cross the blood-brain barrier, which means it is very likely not to give you serious related adverse effects. So those are things that you can deduce from just knowing the plasma protein binding level of the drug. So if it's highly plasma protein bound, it most likely will not cross the blood-brain barrier, which means it most likely will not do the CNS adverse effects. So that's how that drug is bound. Now, if you're talking about the M, that is the metabolism, the drug actually is excreted mostly unchanged. In other words, there is no metabolism to speak of as such. Okay, so about 90% of the administered drug will be excreted unchanged. 80% of that would actually be through the enterohepatic system. Only about 5% of the drug will go out in urine. So that tells you that if the patient has renal dysfunction, that will not affect linagliptin. You can use linagliptin in a patient who has renal dysfunction because it will not affect its pharmacokinetics. However, the drug is a weak inhibitor of your cytochrome P450-3A4. It's a weak inhibitor of 3A4. Now, if you give linagliptin with a drug that stimulates 3A4, you actually get a decrease in effectiveness of linagliptin. Okay, so enzyme stimulators like your phenobarbital, for instance, or like your rifampin, if you give them concurrently with linagliptin, you actually see a decrease in the effectiveness of your linagliptin. So that's its acne in terms of its indication. We know that it is just used in the management of type 2 diabetes mellitus. And it gives you a 0.8 to 0.9% drop in A1C. Okay. And it can be used alone, but it can also be used in combination with other agents. There's a drug called Trigerin. Trigerin that contains linagliptin and metformin and empagliflozin. That's the group we will talk about next time we meet, you know, the SGLT2 inhibitors. So Trigerin has metformin, it has linagliptin, and it has empagliflozin. egg. So the negative thing can be used with other agents. That's a drug called Glyzambi, which has linagliptin and your empagliflozin in it. So don't confuse trigeny with syngeny. Syngeny only has two drugs in it. And that's your empagliflozin plus metformin. That's what you have in Syngeny. Empagliflozin plus metformin. But Trigeny has your linagliptin, empagliflozin, and your metformin. So it can be used with other agents. And finally, the adverse effects of your linagliptin. One, hypoglycemia. The same statement we made earlier would be true for linagliptin. You are likely to see that hypoglycemia if you give the drug concurrently with sulfonylurea or with insulin. So if you administer it concurrently with a sulfonylurea or you administer it concurrently with insulin, you are more likely to get that hypoglycemia. And it can cause nasopharyngitis. Nasopharyngitis, so a patient of linagliptin can start having nasal stuffiness, sometimes a runny nose. It's a manifestation of that nasopharyngitis that it can produce. Pancreatitis, just like those incretinomimetics, linagliptin can also produce pancreatitis. Okay. And then pain. Pain in the back, so back pain. Pain in the head. Headaches, pain in the muscles, okay, myalgia, and then pain in the joints, arthralgia. Okay. So it can cause headaches, it can cause back pain, it can cause arthralgia, and it can cause myalgia. And those are adverse effects. All right, we'll stop there. And questions?
Is the reason you don't use DPP-4 with GLPs because you don't want to overload like the GLP and GIP process? Since your inhibitor is going to allow your body